Antonio Salgado. And pitcher number 28, Vitaly Jengels. And now, the starting lineup for your Lamar Cardinals. Leading off in right field, a junior from Humble, number 42, Avery Shore. Batting second in center field, a senior from Gross, number 22, Cole Girard. Hitting third, the designated hitter, a senior from Huffman, number 7, Paul Cooper. Batting fourth at second base, the senior from Santa Kingsville, Puerto Rico, number 5, J.C. Correa. Hitting fifth at first base, the junior from Eagle, number 17, Chase Kemp. Batting sixth at third base, the senior from Dixville, Quebec, Canada, number 16, Anthony Thurion. Batting seventh in left field, the sophomore from Jasper, number 1, Reese Duran. Hitting eighth at shortstop, the sophomore from Village Mills, number 11, Kelly Weiler. And batting ninth and catching, a junior from Montelview, number 4, Rex McCall. Pitching for your Cardinals today, a junior from Magnolia, number 37, Austin Faith. Ladies and gentlemen, we now ask that you please stand and remove your hats as we honor America with the playing of our national anthem.
And a good morning. Welcome to Vincent Beck Stadium for Lamar University Baseball. Cardinals looking for the sweep as they get set for the final game against the Rams of Rhode Island. Hi, everybody. I'm Harold Mann along with Lamar Cardinal Jorge Gutierrez. And Jorge, a good start for Lamar, both offensively and defensively. No errors to this point, and pitching's been solid for the first two.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, you love to see it. It's always good for a team to come out strong and have all aspects of the game rolling for them, especially this early in the year on opening weekend.
Pitching this afternoon for the Cardinals is Austin Faith. It's going to be our first look at him for Lamar University. And a little bit of Austin, a righty, 6'6", tall kid, 200-pounder out of Magnolia, played at A&M Kingsville. and also at Navarro Junior College. What's he going to show us this afternoon or this morning?
This guy, Austin Faith, I like to call him Shaggy because he's got the long hair and he dresses like the cartoon character. But this guy pounds his zone. He's got sharp, aggressive stuff, and he's got a lot of tempo. Reminds me a lot of Trevin Michael, except if Trevin Michael took one of those Mario mushrooms and grew about 6 inches.
There you go. Josh Brodeur will lead it off. 286 Brodeur is in the first two ball games. 2 out of 7 with a run scored. Left-handed hitter. He is out of Cumberland, Rhode Island. Went to Cumberland High School. First pitch swinging. And it's going to be fouled down towards the left side. Reese Durant giving it a look. Morning starts. Much of a difference?
I think depends on the ball player. Obviously, guys want to get to sleep in a little more. But the good part about morning games is that they end much quicker. So you got the rest of the day to just do whatever you need to do.
Austin Faith delivers the 0-1. Shows bunt. Austin will field it. Good strong throw to first base. A good job getting off the mound and getting that first out of the game.
And that's one of the instances right there, Harold, where it shows that pitchers are athletes. You know, sometimes position players, as position players, give them a lot of hate for not really doing much, but they are athletic, and Austin showed a good job of it right there, bouncing off the mound.
Mark Coley steps in, 167 on the weekend. One up, one down here in the top half of the first inning. First pitch swinging. Foul third base side. Key to the game, I mean, we talked about this Friday night, Jorge, is the pitchers working in front of hitters.
Well, yeah, and yesterday you saw kind of Zach Bravo getting a couple of holes, but that was just because he was walking guys, and then he got out of them just because he stopped walking guys. And it goes to show again how important minimizing the base on ball ratio is and how important it is to just throw strikes and let the hitters get themselves out.
No balls, one strike on Coley with Coots waiting on deck. Ball's going to be popped up out towards right field. Everybody giving chase, and Avery George, a Cardinal right fielder, will come in and make the play. That's a lot of communication when you're going out there on who's going to take charge.
Oh, yeah, that right there is called the Bermuda Triangle just because it's the sweet spot between the first, second, and right fielder. And it's just a lot of talking. Usually the right fielder is going to take that ball, but if the first baseman or second baseman has a better read, they're okay to call it too. But Avery did a good job of coming in and making that play.
Jackson Coots, he homered on Friday night. DH, a 250 hitter through the first two games. Left-hander. Doesn't look like wind's much of a factor this morning at all. Kind of heavy air because it was foggy. The fog is just over the last hour started to lift.
Yeah, usually one thing that I will say about the Beck is that morning games, the ball tends to fly a lot better just because the wind hasn't really picked up and the fog's still kind of out, and the ball just seems to carry a little bit out before noon. So we'll see if that happens.
No balls, one strike. Austin Faith. Good hard throw, but it's up for a ball. Sean O'Brien, the third base coach. Jacob Capstein, the first base coach of Rhode Island. Head coach is Rafael Serrato. 1-1 pitch, that's fouled off on the left side. Tell you, those might have tuned in on YouTube yesterday for the video only. I like those black uniforms. Those are sharp looking.
Yeah, they look good. They look good. And because they're so new, they look blacker or darker than the old ones, so they pop a little bit.
1-2 pitch on the way. That's going to be fouled off right side.
And that's exactly what you'd expect him to do if he were to hit that pitch right there. That's a back foot slider, and if he isn't going to strike out, you want him to foul it about 40 feet foul. So that's just what that pitch was intended to do right there.
One ball, two strikes. Xavier Vargas waits on deck. Cardinals just as soon see him in the second inning. Now Coots will step out. Kind of shaded left center a little bit. Gerard is out in center. Pitch low and inside for a ball above the shoe tops. 2-2. Cardinals return home. on the 25th against UTSA. 2-2 pitch on the way. That's going to be popped up. As Kelby Weiler goes out, makes a catch at shortstop. Quick work in the top half of the first inning. No runs, no hits, no errors, no one left. Half inning of a baseball behind us. From Vincent Beck in Beaumont, it's Rhode Island nothing. Lamar coming to bat.
There are two locations in town. Buffalo Wild Wings, your next stop for the big Cardinals game.
Harold Manlong with Jorge Gutierrez as the Lamar Cardinals come to bat here in the bottom half of the first inning. Avery George, Cole Girard, and Cole Coker coming to the plate for the Cardinals. George 222 for the first two ball games, facing Vitaly Jangles. First pitch on the way is inside for a ball. Jangles is a senior right-hander, 6'1", 205, from Tuxedo Park, New York. Pitches pops up and out of play. We get it started here in the bottom of the first inning.
Well, Avery's a great leadoff guy because he, once he gets on, he's just such a threat on the base pass, and Cole being able to bunt him over just opens up a lot of possibilities for the inning.
1-1 pitch on the way, misses outside for a ball. Lamar taking the first two, looking for the sweep against Rhode Island. That pitching matchup between Michael and Cherry on Friday night was a lot of fun. There's a good way to start for the Cardinals with a sharp hit into left field.
That's Avery George special right there. That's the Avery George special. Sometimes he'll tell me last year he would come up to me and be like, you know what, man, swing feels good. I'm just going to see if I can hit it over the shortstop's head, and it's exactly what he does. He literally thinks about his approach, and it sticks to it really well.
You talk about a grind-nosed baseball player, one step into the batter box right now. Center fielder Cole Girard still looking for his first hit of the year. He's made good contact for the first two ball games, but hitting him right at people. Show him bunt, pulls the bat back, and then, of course, those two catches on Friday night just remarkable.
Yeah, Cole can do it all, you know, and he's had good at-bats, and he's a mature guy. He knows that even though he doesn't get a base hit every time, his at-bats are quality, and that's important because sometimes you get carried away and trying to find a base hit, and Cole knows that he's been doing a pretty good job at the plate, even though the hits don't show it.
Fouls that one back, 1-1. One ball, one strike, maybe a hit and run. We'll see what the Cardinals have coming up here.
Oh, you know, Coach Davis is definitely thinking about it at least.
Get that runner moving into the scoring position with some good sticks coming up behind him. There's a throw to first. Avery dives back in safely.
And I know Avery is thinking about being aggressive here. He's definitely, you know, early in the game, first inning, wanted to get as many extra bases as he can, so he's looking for a dirt ball here.
Pitch on the way, swinging. Oh, my goodness. There's nothing he can do about that. Lined in to a double play. Tell you, Cole Girard hit that ball right on the nose, caught by Vargas at first. And Avery George was caught in dead man's land. There was nothing he could do.
He can't do anything about that. That's literally the only instance that Coach Davis said he's fine getting doubled off in a line drive. I mean, the ball's just hit right at the first baseman, and there's nothing you can do. You got to just tip your cap and get him the next AB.
Base is empty. Two down for Cole Coker. 250 average for Cole.
Well, shout out to Cole's older brother for getting married last night. That's why Cole wasn't at the game yesterday. His brother was getting married.
Out of Huffman.
Yes, sir.
There's a ball toward short. Fielded. Throw to first. In time for the putout. Well, the Cardinals got off what to look like to be a good start, but a hard luck line drive double play shortens the inning. No runs on a hit, no errors, and nobody left. Scoreless after one at Vincent Beck. One inning behind us, moved to the top of the second inning here on a Sunday morning baseball at Vincent Beck Stadium. 4, 5, and 6 coming up here for the Rams of Rhode Island. Xavier Vargas, 125. He does have a hit. That hit was a home run. The high pitch misses up to that one. Maybe slipped out of his hand a little bit in the early release. One ball, no strikes.
Something I think that Coach Davis does real well is organizing the defense. I mean, you see the infield shifted towards the pull side, but the outfield's kind of shifted towards opposite field because it doesn't necessarily mean always that they're going to pull a ball in the air. You know, sometimes they'll hit the ball more in the gaps, and most of the time it goes to show how good Coach Davis and Sneddon and Coach Haddon do their research because it pays off most of the time.
3-0. Awesome Faith ready to come into Vargas. Catches the outside corner, taken all the way, of course. But he didn't give anything right down the heart of the plate.
Yeah, no, you don't want to throw him a meatball, especially since we know that the Rhode Island Rams like to take 3-0 hacks.
3-1 pitch on the way. There's a high chopper toward first. Cole steps on it and takes the first out of the inning.
You love that as Austin Faith, starting out 3-0 in the inning, you know, and then come back and getting a weak rollover there. It's got to be a good feeling knowing it's like a fresh start. That's a good example of just letting the hitter get themselves out because, you know, it's hard getting a hit. You got 9 guys out there, 8 guys trying to catch your ball. Sometimes just throw it up there, and the hitter is going to find a way to just hit it to someone, which is what happened right there.
First pitch taking ball one to Sonny Juliana. 286 in the first two games, the catcher. Good tough hitter in this lineup for the Rams. Faith comes in with a 1-0 pitch. That ball's fouled back up and out of play, 1-1. Going back to Vargas, and you're right, 3-0. A pitcher could really well, you know, pack it in and maybe mentally break down to that one at bat, but he didn't.
Yeah, no, that was just all mental focus right there, because, you know, you got to bear down in some parts of the game more than others, and he did a great job.
Here comes a 1-1. Good-looking pitch catches the outside corner. Michael Grishman calling balls and strikes. Jaron Higdon at first. Phil Bando at third. The umpiring crew here for this final game of the three-game series. Cardinals looking for the sweep. Ball hit out towards center field. Money in the Bank will be out there to cash it in for out number two.
Well, it was a can of corn. And that was a fly out to center, which, you know, that was the job that was intended. But Sned's probably in the dugout shaking his head because he knows that Austin just hung that slider. You know, in a perfect world, you want that two-strike slider down and away, see if he can chase, because he hit it hard, just Cole Gerard happened to be there. But if that was more in the gap, that's a double. You don't want that with two strikes.
Alex Ramirez, shortstop 333. Waits for the first pitch. That ball just hit high in the air. It's like Kelby Wyler, the shortstop, calling for it, and he does and makes the final catch. Route number three, quick work in the second. No runs, no hits, no errors, no one left. Scoreless between Lamar and Rhode Island head into the bottom half of the second inning. Head to the bottom after the second inning, J.C. Correa, Cole Kemp, and Anthony Carrion do up for the Cardinals. J.C. off to a great weekend, 7 out of 9, 778. First pitch of him swinging out. He just gets after. He's aggressive. He's hacking away.
I'm telling you, Harold, this guy woke up, had his cereal or whatever that he did, and was just thinking about that slider that he just threw. He's already locked. He's been locked in since last night, and I wouldn't be surprised if he found a barrel right here.
0-1 pitch, good pitch, has him swinging out above it. It's 0-2. Look at that, 778 and 0. We're only two games into the season, but obviously through the first 2 days in collegiate baseball, one of the top averages in the country. 0-2 pitch on the way, makes contacts, and a pop it up on the right side. Long way for everybody to run, and that ball is going to be caught and over the shoulder. Basket catch, Xavier Vargas taking a double away from J.C. Correa. A great defensive play down that first base line.
And that was the opposite instance of what happened with Avery coming in, you know, because Bowley was shifted more towards a gap. The first baseman had to just turn and burn and made a great over-the-shoulder play right there.
So the Cardinals, one down here with the Chase Kemp coming to the plate. First pitch outside, another one of the local products, Chase out of Nederland High School. One ball, no strikes. There's a ball hit in the air towards left field. Brodeur makes the catch for out number two. Two up and two down. Anthony Carrion. Second year in the program from Canada. Played JUCO ball out at Clarendon Junior College out near Amarillo.
Wouldn't be surprised if Q took one right here just because the inning's gone by so quickly.
Give Faith a little more rest in the dugout. Well, oh, first pitch swinging. Fly ball to right. Mark Colley should make it for the final out, and he does. A quick 1-2-3 inning in the second. No runs, no hits, no errors, and no one left. We've played two innings of baseball. It is scoreless between Lamar and Rhode Island. Center fielder, 125 average this weekend. Out of Portland, Connecticut. First pitch misses outside for a ball. One ball, no strikes. Cardinals hit the road on Wednesday morning for a game against the University of Texas Wednesday afternoon. Head to San Marcos for games on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. Two balls, no strikes.
Austin White, wouldn't be surprised if he took one here. See if he can get to a 3-0 count. See if he can kind of get something started for the Rams.
Austin Faith comes in. He's tacking at 2-1.
I'm just not.
You're 0 for 2 right now,
I'm
man.
I'm 0 for 3.
Oh, 3 maybe.
3, I think.
Yeah.
Just, I mean, aggressive in the morning, coming out hacking, nothing against that.
Austin gets the sign from Rhett, ready to come in with the 2-1 pitch. Little bit outside, 3-1.
And Austin's so lanky, and he's got that three-quarter arm slot. His ball does run a lot, which is what we're seeing. It's just kind of missing arm side because it's just missing with that little bit last-minute sales, kicking it out of the strike zone.
3-1 pitch on the way, swinging, fouls it out of play, runs the count full. So two different hitters early on here. Austin falls behind in the count, but battles back to run the count full. Leadoff hitter here in the third. Just missed outside for a leadoff walk.
That was a good pitch, just didn't get a piece of the corner that he expected.
Joe Fortin. He's hitting .333 early on here in the season. Again, these numbers are through two games. He's 1-for-3. From Los Angeles, California. See if they decide to bunt or try to move that runner over. Swinging away, There's a 6-3 double play. Just what a pitcher loves, a pitcher's best friend, a ground ball double play.
That's something that Kelby Wilder has done maybe 1,000 times in the fall of practice, that exact play right there, and it pays off perfectly.
I mean, as routine as that is, it really wasn't that routine because the ball did hit the mound going by. That might spin the ball a little bit different.
I think Kelby's heads up enough out there to where that does – I bet he didn't even notice it hit the mound. He slows the game down really well and handles situations like that awesomely.
Tino Salgado steps in, 0-for-1. He got an at-bat yesterday, third baseman. From Bayonne, New Jersey. 1-1.
I feel like Austin might be throwing a little bit harder as the game's progressed. I'm not sure. I wish we had a gun up here, but he looks like the swings are a little bit later than they have been in the earlier innings.
Took something off that one. Looked like a pretty good pitch up just a little bit for a ball, 2-1.
That was one of the sliders right there.
Two-one pitch on the way, fouls it straight back to the screen, 2-2. Got to give Chris Messina a shout-out for going out there and get that ball.
Messina's probably one of the most, if not the most, well-liked guy probably in that dugout. I don't think anyone has ever or will ever have any problem with that guy. What a great guy.
2-2 pitch on the way. Oh, just missed. You can see, including Austin Faith, several Cardinals heading towards the dugout. Does that bother an umpire? Well, now we're going to get a warning towards the Lamar bench. I'm not sure if there's a warning or not, but the home plate umpire, Michael Grisham, pointed towards the Lamar dugout.
I mean, obviously, the umpire doesn't want to be showed up like that, and Austin did a good job just kind of leaning and coming back, but never a fan of those.
No problem there. Swinging a miss at a high fast, and that will do it for the inning. For Rhode Island, no runs on no hits, no errors, and no one left. He's faced a minimum through three. We head to the bottom of the third inning. We are scoreless. Yesterday. Shows bunt. Bunts it back towards the mound. Here's the play to play at first. Got him. Thought it over a little bit. Good play by Vitaly Jangles. Just getting him by about a half a step.
That's another good job of PFP right there. You caught that barehanded. And what most people don't know about that is when you catch it barehanded, you usually got it right in your palm. And to throw it, you got to push it more out towards your fingers. And sometimes that's why you see people airmailing them after barehanding it, because it's a tough transition, you know, from catching it to throwing it. But he did a good job right there.
Another new guy in the lineup, although he's here during his transfer year last year, is Kelby Wyler, 5'71", went to Warren High School, headed over to Rice following high school, sat out last year when he transferred to Lamar. 2-2. Not a bad idea there by Duran trying to get something started by getting on base with a bunt. Taking here?
If he swings right here, man, I don't even know what just – I mean, I don't think there's any way he swings right here. He definitely is trying to get on 3-0.
There's a called strike. Yep. On a 3-0, the only time I really like maybe a 3-0 swing, if you got a power hitter up there and there's runners on base, maybe
right.
a runner at third base.
Right.
Strike two, so it's now 3-2, two takes. Two right. good pitches there by Jangles.
I mean, Kelby is comfortable enough up there to where he can take two of those and still battle with two strikes.
3-2 pitch on the way, fights that one off towards the Lamar bullpen area. Three balls, two strikes, and Rhett McCall waiting on deck. There's a ball hit out towards center field. White coming in, makes a diving catch for out number two. A diving catch out there by Austin White, taking a base hit away from Kelby Wyler. Good play out there in center.
And I'll tell you what, Harold, Austin White's only got a couple good barrels and not a lot going on for him offensively this weekend, but he has made some plays look really easy out there in center.
The only dangerous part when you do that forward dive, if that skips under your glove, Wyler's still running.
Oh, that's inside the par if that gets by him, but Austin White did a good job of just keeping that in front of him.
He made the out. Rhett McCall looking for his first hit of the year, 0-4. No score, as you see, in the bottom half of the third inning. Bases empty, two down. There's a grounder to short. Ah, olayed it. Ramirez will commit the error. Then he's going to throw the baseball, and that should be two errors on that play. We'll wait and see. I would think that would be two errors, one for the mishandle and then one for throwing the ball away.
Unfortunately, that's just one of those times where you try not to make two, but you mess it up, and then you see if you can save yourself, and you ended up making two mistakes instead of one, and that cost him two bases. And let's see if Avery can capitalize on that mistake and see if we get the first run of the game.
Well, right now it's going as a one-error, two-base error. As a runner at second base for the Cardinals, and we go. Okay, that's what we're going to do. We're going to do E6 in an advance. Top of the batting order, Avery George got a base hit his first time up, doubled up on a line out by Gerard. Runner at second base, base hit here could give the Cardinals the lead. Pitch to Avery. That ball is going to be hit out towards left center field. Cardinals do take that 1-0 lead. On the hit by Avery George, who's 2-for-2.
You know, we talk a lot about JC hitting, but, you know, this guy, Avery George, he can hit too. And not only that, he looks – it's almost annoying being on his team because it looks like he's not even trying up there. It looks like he's just woke up and he's like, whatever, I guess I'll get four hits today. And he does it pretty much every day. It's amazing.
Cole Gerard 0-for-1 lined into a double play, and a play where he hit the ball really hard his first time up, but a liner right at first baseman Vargas, who caught the ball, then tagged out Avery George, who had led off the inning with a single. No balls, one strike. Vitale Jangles. Ready to come in with the pitch, high and outside. It's 1-1. One ball, one strike. Cole Coker waits on deck.
Be a good spot to steal right here.
One and two. Boy, Cole, he turns around and
he didn't like that one.
Talking to Michael Grisham, the home plate umpire. From up here again, we're up a ways. That ball did look like it was up a little bit out of the zone.
I mean, you got to give the catcher credit. Sometimes we forget that the catcher is making the ball look – he's presenting it to the umpire. So when it's a bad call, called a strike, instead of getting upset, I usually just think about how the catcher's the one who did a good job because he stole the call.
Twos across the board, 22. Two balls, two strikes, two outs. All twos across the top of the scoreboard in right center. Runner going on a ball and a throw down to second and safe.
There we go.
Don't know, maybe Giuliani might have trouble handling that ball a little bit. But Avery George gets a stolen base.
Finally, something happened, I predicted. About time.
It's about time, you know. Figured it might come in game 13 or 14.
I was due. I was due. No, but that's good because, I mean, even if Cole strikes out here, you still got 3, 4, 5 start off next inning. And now you got Avery in scoring position. So if a bloop single happens or another error happens, instead of Avery just getting a third, that's another run.
Three balls, two strikes on Cole Girard. Pitch on the way, fights it off. Stays at 3-2. Had a bunt out, a fly out, an error, and a two-base error, and then a base RBI single by Avery George. He's out at second base now. Three balls, two strikes on Girard. 3-2 pitch on the way, swing and a miss, strike three to retire the side. But the Cardinals strike first, one run, one hit, one error, and one left. Through three at Vincent Beck Stadium, it's now Lamar 1, Rhode Island nothing.
Cardinals fans, it's time for the ExxonMobil trivia question of the game.
Next year.
That's the plan. That's the plan.
Well, good rehab, you'll get it done.
Oh, yeah.
First pitch to Josh Bedore. Called a strike. He tried to bunt his way on to start the ball game. Austin Faith, Cardinals pitcher, able to throw him out. The 0-1 pitch on the way, swinging. There's a grounder to second. J.C. Correa on to first, no problem. For someone like J.C., I mean, obviously it's in his blood, baseball is. Moving from short, he played a third yesterday. Moving from third, short, and second, is that much of an adjustment defensively?
I mean, it's something that he works on really hard. I feel like he's comfortable enough anywhere just because he works hard at it. But some people might get uncomfortable, but J.C. just loves doing it. You know, it's fun. It's fun for him being able to play a lot of stuff and practice. I think Kobe Bryant said, you know, it's not the success that counts, it's the practicing to get to the success that is what he likes to do the most.
Mark Cauley flew to right his first time up. Two balls, no strikes. And, of course, and he does have visions, and I think will play at the next level. If you're a versatile player, that's an advantage.
Oh, absolutely. You know, the more you can do, the more value you bring to a team. So that's something that J.C. definitely brings to the table.
2-0 pitch on the way. Upstairs, ball three. 3-0.
Rhett's just going to give him the old one right here to throw right down the middle. No walks. Don't want any walks.
Swinging and hits a base hit into left field. We talked about that earlier on a 3-0 count, how aggressive of a hitting team Rhode Island is.
And it's a risk. It's a risk-reward thing, I feel like, because maybe if he didn't hit that, that could have been a ball, and he almost hit it right at Q. So even though you could hit a 3-0 pitch perfectly, you could hit it perfectly right at someone, and you just get yourself out of a free base right there. So sometimes it pays off, and sometimes it doesn't.
That time for Collier did. Here's Jackson Coots. Popped up to short to end the first. Pitch is down low, scooped up there by Rhett to McCall.
Rhett tried to do a little deke right there.
That.
Rhett's a smart guy, you know. He'll fool you, but he's a pretty smart guy. I'm sure he's actually going to get someone this year with that deke. Maybe not today, maybe not next week, but I bet he gets someone by the end of the season's over with that deke.
Ready for the one out. Coots calls timeout. And what Jorge's talking about there, Rhett gave the initial indication as if the ball might have got by him, hoping the runner at first base would make a break. There's one hit off the end of the bat towards third, and it's going to be foul. Good job by Q at third base to get over there and get on that ball as soon as it's in foul territory, because if he fields it, I don't think he has a chance to throw Coots out.
You know, that would have been a really tough play, especially having to throw across your body all the way from third. That's just smart right there, knowing that it'd be better to just get a strike out of it instead of maybe risking an error and a run, throwing that ball away.
Runner at first with one out, a ground out by Brodeur to start the inning. Colley single to left field. Austin Faith pitching for the Cardinals. Got the start, working into the fourth inning. Pitch sails inside above the feet for a ball, 2-1. Turning out to be a really good day here in Beaumont. Yesterday and Friday, a little bit of chilly Friday night and yesterday afternoon. Good baseball weather today.
It's nice golf weather, if you ask me.
That's why you've got the 10 o'clock start. He could hit the greens about 3 this afternoon.
There's
a
throw
to first base. Got him leading.
That was a great pickoff, man.
That was a beautiful move over there.
And that was the first pick he's done, I believe, all game. So, I mean, it's not like they'd seen any move before. That was just smart by Faith right there.
Well, they'd only had one other base runner, and he didn't throw over that time.
You know, I've seen Austin on the dance floor, and he can't really move, but he looks to be a little bit more comfortable on his feet on the mound, so that's good.
Well, I mean, after all, you do call him Shaggy.
Yeah.
The 2-1 pitch on the way, swinging, lifts it in the air. Reese Duran, left fielder, comes over a few steps and makes the catch for the final out of the inning. So for a one-out base hits, eliminated still, faced a minimum through the 3.5. No runs on a hit, no errors, no one left. Head to the bottom of the fourth inning. Cardinals leading it 1-0. Thank you. Head to the bottom half of inning number four. Cardinals will send up 3, 4, and 5. Cole Coker, the designated hitter, grounded out to short his first time up. Gets set to face Vitaly Jangles. Shows bunt, bunts it foul. That's a good job, really good look there by Cole. He looked and saw how deep Salgado was playing at third.
Yeah, I mean, Cole's a pretty beefy guy, but he does a pretty good job of reading the defense and knowing where he can place one down and see if he can get a sneaky base hit.
No balls, one strike. The 0-1 pitch fouled on the first base side. First base coach Hunter Doucette makes a lackless effort for it. Scott Hatton over at third. Pitching coach Sean Snedeker and head coach Will Davis in the dugout. Lifts it out towards left field. Brodeur, long way to run, coming over, makes the catch as he nears the line for out number one. Going opposite way there for Cole Coker. Sent it a long way, but it's a long out.
That goes to show, Harold, that the wind's not really doing anything, because if that was Friday night, I think that ball doesn't go that far. I mean, that ball was almost a warning track, and Cole definitely didn't even come close to hitting it well. So I think if JC gets into one right here, he could hit it out.
Correa hit the ball his first time and was robbed of a beautiful play by Xavier Vargas going down the first base line, making an over-shoulder catch. A ball that if he doesn't get to, drops in for a double. 0-1 pitch, fouls it right back to the screen. It's 0-2. Kind of curious, and you may know the answer to this. I asked it last year why he chose 5 and not number 1 when he got here.
I think that's just his number. I think he just likes number 5. I never actually asked him that question.
The 0-2 pitch on the way. The reason I asked that is his older brother wears number 1 for the Astros.
Yeah, that's a good question. I'll probably ask him after this, and I'm kind of curious to see what he says. I think it might have to do with his favorite player or something growing up.
1-2 pitch fouled over by Scott Hatton at third base. Stays 1-2. And it might go back to something we talked about Friday. You know, he wants to be JC and not Carlos' little brother.
Oh, absolutely. And he is JC. You know, he's his own guy. Even though they do have their similarities, I think JC is proud of everything that he does different. And like that's just that brother competitiveness, you know.
There's a ball hit towards third. Knocked down by Salgado. Fires across for the second out of the inning. Chase Kemp, Cardinal first baseman, flew to left his first time up. Two up, two down here in the bottom of the fourth inning. Lamar leading at 1-0.
Chase Kemp is a strong individual, ladies and gentlemen. With two outs here, you know, the Cardinals have a lead. I think Chase is probably going to want to hit some hard, so I wouldn't be surprised if we saw a daddy hack right here.
First pitch swinging, and that's going to be hit down the right side and into the Lamar bullpen. Mark Culley, the right fielder, giving a long run and a look. No balls, one strike. Lamar and Rhode Island. Pops it up. Coming back towards the stands. And we'll be in the stands for strike two, 0-2. Anthony Kirion waiting on deck. Base is empty, two down and a 1-0 Lamar lead.
That's a really good take.
Yeah.
That's a really good take right there.
And on the other side, a really good pitch here by Jangles to try to get him a chase.
Yeah, I mean, I think that just shows me that Kemp's locked in up there, because, I mean, if it's me up there, I'm already in the dugout swinging at that one.
1-2 pitch, an excuse me swing towards third base, fire onto first for the put out. End of fourth for the Cardinals. No runs, no hits, no errors, and no one left. After four, it's Lamar 1, Rhode Island nothing. Gutierrez, Cardinal baseball this afternoon at Vincent Beck Stadium. 4, 5, and 6 coming up in the batting order for the visitors from Rhode Island. Xavier Vargas, Sonny Juliana, and Alex Ramirez.
And now it being the second time through the order, let's see how the Rams do have their adjustments with Austin Faith, who's been looking pretty comfortable up there on the mound.
Ready for the first pitch of the fifth. Drops in for a strike. One run, two hits. No errors for Lamar. No runs, one hit. And an error on Rhode Island. Faith comes in with the pitcher. A swing and a miss for a strike. It's 0-2. No balls, two strikes. Up a little bit for a ball. Not a bad 0-2 pitch there.
I mean, you got to throw him the high heat, see if he chases it. And I think he's put a little bit something behind that. Austin throws hard. I mean, with someone who being 6'6", you'd expect him to throw hard, and he does.
A 1-2 pitch on the way. Called strike three at the letters.
Frozen.
High strike. Yeah, you're right. It locked him at the plate.
Frozen. I mean, that was just a fastball that Vargas probably thought he was going to be in, and then that last second tail got the inside of the corner. And there's not much you can do, I mean, but tip your cap. As right there, that's just good pitching.
Second strikeout for Austin Faith. Sonny Juliana flew to center his first time up. He's 0-1. First pitch swinging misses, 0-1. Cardinals pitching to this point through the first two and a third of these games been solid, 1-1.
That's something you love to see. You know, that's something you love to see, especially after last year and the question marks of the starting rotation and having our new starters come out and do a good job. It's exciting.
1-1 pitch, a swing and a miss for a strike. It's 1-2. That was pitch number 50 by Austin Faith. 1-2 pitch on the way, up a little bit for a ball, 2-2. Comes that 2-2 pitch, down low, scooped up by Rhett McGall. Giving him a lot of room in left center.
It's looking like, according to Coach Davis in their research, I don't think Mr. Juliana hits the ball to left center very often.
It doesn't hit it at all there. There's a swing and a miss. Sonic goes down swinging, second strikeout of the inning. Third of the game for Austin Faith. Here's Alex Ramirez, popped out to short to end the second inning. With Austin Faith set to face the lefty, first pitch inside just above the knees for a called ball. One-oh pitch on the way, misses. Other Lamar sports, Lamar men's basketball with a 10-point win yesterday over Houston Baptist. Two balls, no strikes to Ramirez. 2-0 pitch on the way, that's fouled first base side. Goes 2-1. The 2-1-2 out pitch on the way, popped up high in the air towards shallow left, and Reese Durand will come in and make the catch for the final out of the inning. No runs, no hits, no errors, and no one left. Bottom of the fifth we go, 1-0 Lamar.
Fans, just a reminder, our concession stands are open today. They're located behind the first base stands.
He flew to right his first time up. Durand and Weiler to follow. Should someone reach, Rhett McCall will come to the plate. Jangles comes in with his first pitch. First pitch swing and sent out towards right field. And that will be gloved out in right field by Coley. One pitch, one out here in the fifth.
Left fielder, number one, Reese Durand.
Reese Durand, Cardinals left fielder, tried to bunt his way on. His first time up, leading off the bottom of the third. Grounded back to the mound, thrown out on a bang-bang play. Beat him by about a step on a good play by Vitaly Jangles, the pitcher. One ball, no strikes.
I know Reese wants to swing right here. This guy wants to swing and wants to hit. Last at bat, he didn't get a bunt. See if he gets a barrel right here.
Fouls it back, 1-1. Fought off a pretty good pitch here.
Yeah, that was a pretty good pitch.
This will be Jangles' 50th pitch of the day.
Vitaly Jangles on a 1-1 pitch. Pitch number 50 is called a ball. 2-1. I'm not counting them. Cooper is next one.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm glad I don't got that job.
Yeah. Two balls, one strike. Sails outside, ball three, and this is where Duran get really focused in. This is the hitter's pitch at 3-1. Look for something you like. You can drive it somewhere. If not, you've got another pitch coming. Drew the walk.
Good at bat. That was a good at bat right there. Sometimes when you get to 3-1, you get so anxious and so excited that you know a fastball's coming that you forget that you're supposed to swing at strikes and you just swing at whatever just because you get so over-anxious up there at the box.
First walk surrendered in this game by Vitaly Jangles. He's doing a great job. We'll talk about the job Austin Faith doing for Lamar. Well, Vitaly Jangles has answered it. Lamar leads at 1-0 here in the fifth.
And that's got some movement happening in the Rhode Island bullpen.
First pitch swing and hits it hard and deep to left fielder. Brodeur going back, still going back, still going back. Look up, and that ball's off the wall. Rounding third, coming home is Durant on his way to third for the double is Kelby Wyler. He didn't miss it by much getting out of here.
And Kelby, you know, doesn't look like a strong guy at the plate, but let me tell you, folks, he's got some sneaky pop in there, you know. It almost looked like he got jammed right there, and he was able to keep the barrel on it and hit it all the way to the fence, which here at the Beck is not an easy feat. So he hit that ball pretty well.
And you talked about this a couple of bats ago about Friday night. That ball would not have carried that far, but today it has a little carry to left.
Yeah, I think because it's still in the morning and it's still not windy, the ball's just going to jump a little bit more to left field because Friday night I think that would just be an F7. But fortunately for Kelby, it's Sunday, and he just got a triple with an RBI.
Cardinals take a 2-0 lead. Get a visit to the mound with Rhode Island. I believe this is going to be Kevin Vance out there. He's listed as the mound visiting coach. The head coach, Rafael Serrato, will come out to make pitching changes. So the Cardinals with a runner at third base now and less than two outs.
Now with this being less than two out, all Rhett McCall is up there at the plate thinking is just hit a ball past the infield, maybe a deep fly ball or see if you can bloop one over the infield being in so you can get that run in. Priority one is not necessarily to get a base hit but to put the ball somewhere to where that run could score because being up 3-0 is a lot different than being up 2-0.
Pitch on the way, takes it downstairs for a ball. Got a double barrel action, a righty and lefty. Actually, just a lefty throwing, the righty standing there stretching. So got a lefty warming up in the bullpen for the Rams. 1-0 pitch on the way, outside for a ball. As Jorge mentioned, the infield is tight, trying to cut that run off at home plate. And Rhett's job is just try to slap one by him. So heavy swing,
good
foul
swing.
Tipped.
Good swing. Maybe a little bit much for what the goal is, but I like it. I like it, Rhett. Why not? See it, swing it.
Two balls, one strike.
No, after that swing, though, I'm Rhett, you get one of those in an at-bat like this.
There's a ball that bounces away, not far enough. Don't want to chance it there. It's 3-1. And now this is where Rhett has really got to be licking his chops at 3-1.
And as a pitcher right here for the Rams, you got to be thinking, okay, I can't give him a fastball right down the middle because then he's going to do his job. But I also can't try to do too much with the ball and get it past the catcher because then Mr. Wyler is going to score. So you got to maybe try to throw it outside, see if he can ground out here.
Fights it back 3-2. And a walk sets up a double play.
Right, right. So obviously right here, this situation is they're just trying to get Rhett to get himself out, and Rhett's just trying to do whatever he can to get that run in. You know, this situation, it's a big part of the game because like I said earlier, it's a different feeling in the dugout when you're down by three runs instead of two runs because two runs can come, three doubles, bang, bang, tie game, but it's kind of hard to get four doubles in a row.
3-2 pitch fouled back. It stays at 3-2. Especially when you have the top of the batting order and Avery George on deck who's 2-for-2.
I'm pretty sure that's why those arms are moving in the pen because they know that Mr. George is seeing the ball well today at the plate. I don't know if they want him to face a guy for the third time, especially with a runner in scoring position.
3-2 pitch on the way, still fights it off. Are there days a hitter's at the plate where you do actually feel and see the ball better?
It's hard to explain, Harold, but those days do happen, and they happen seemingly out of nowhere. Sometimes you
see
the
ball.
It looks like a
beach ball.
It looks
like
a watermelon's being thrown at you, and sometimes you might be seeing it well, but it feels like there's an invisible hole in your bat. And those days happen seemingly just as often as the days where you see the ball like a watermelon.
3-2 pitch on the way, pops it back up and out of play. This is a very good at-bat right now for Rhett McCall.
I'd call this at-bat already a win, regardless of the outcome of what this at-bat happens, just because he's seen so many pitches and he's already made the pitcher work so hard. Whatever happens already is a good at-bat. Everyone's going to give him a high five when he gets in the dugout just because he's battled and he's working up there. So no matter what happens, Rhett's already done a great job here.
3-2 pitch on the way. There's a ground ball towards third. Going to come home with a throw and throw him out at home plate. Be a fielder's choice for Rhett McCall. And gunned down 5-2 for the second out is Kelby Weiler. He was running on contact, and we're getting a visit to the mound. It'll be a pitching change here in Beaumont. Lamar leads it 2-0. New pitcher in the ball game for the Rhode Island Rams is Jake Walker, 6'3", 230-pound left-handed senior from Milton, Massachusetts, where he went to Milton High School. Partial line on Vitaly Jangles, 4 2/3 innings, 3 hits, 2 runs, one of them earned, had a strikeout and a walk through 62 pitches, 42 of them being strikes, runner at first base. With Rhett McCall is his responsibility.
And Jangles didn't necessarily get pulled because he was doing a bad job. It was one of the instances where Avery George, who had seen him twice already, was going to come up to the plate, and he'd gotten 2 hits. And, you know, once you get to the third time around a lineup, you don't want to keep a pitcher out there too long, especially if you know that the guys on the other team have barreled up some balls pretty well. Because after the second time goes around, the third time, I think the average goes up about on average 100 points, you know, just because you get more comfortable facing the same guy.
So will be Avery George stepping to the plate, singled into first, singled RBI single, and stole a base, drove in the Cardinals' first run in the third inning. Cardinals lead it here 2-0, adding a run here in the fifth. The junior out of Humble. Or Jake Walker comes upstairs for a ball, 1 ball and no strikes. Okay. McCall, your runner at first base, reached on a fielder's choice, way upstairs for a ball. Have a righty throwing in the Rhode Island bullpen. Some players just sitting around in Lamar bullpen. Walker checks into his catcher, Juliana, for the sign. Hit him.
Dead ball.
Avery throws the bat over towards the first base side. A little frustrated there.
He'll probably take up that frustration and maybe write a song about it later. For the viewers at home that don't know, Avery George, he's a pretty good baseball player, I'd say, but his future might not be in baseball. It might be as a music producer. He's one of the few guys on the team that are pretty musically gifted, and the guy coming up to play, Cole Gerard, pretty good singer as well.
What about the guy to my right now?
No comment. No comment on that guy.
I wouldn't comment on myself either. Here is Cole Gerard, lined out and struck out, 0 for 2. Shows bunt, pulls the bat to back, called strike one. The line out, he hit that ball right aft. Xavier Vargas at first base, who was in a right spot, gloved it, then tagged out George, who had led the inning off into first with a base hit.
Oh, and I'm sure Cole wants to barrel something else up, because when you line out, I feel like that lingers with you throughout the game. You know, you think about that when you're in the outfield. You're like, man, I wish that ball got through. So he really wants one right here.
The 0-1 pitch pulls the bat back again. Still playing deep at third base. And with the speed of Cole Gerard, if he lays it down that third base side, now third baseman Salgado will come in a little bit, but not much.
He might still try to do it again. Cole's fast enough, and he's good enough bunter to where even if he's not fully up, he still might try to get it in front of him, beat it out.
Maybe drag it on the first base line with the pitcher falling away, being a left-hander. Pitch goes 2-1. Did not show it on that pitch. 2-1, 2-on, 2-out, 2-0 Lamar here in the bottom of the fifth inning. Misses ball 3. Now Cole can get really excited here. Two runners on, first and second. 2 outs, 3-1 pitch.
Big pitch coming up.
Jake Walker in relief of Vitaly Jangles for Rhode Island comes in with the pitch. Ball 4. They are loaded for Cole Coker.
Look at this guy, Cole Coker, coming up to the plate. He loves situations like these. Bases loaded, you know, pretty close game, lefty on lefty. I always ask Cole how he feels, you know, hitting against lefties, and he tells me that normally people are uncomfortable, but for him, it's never really been an issue, you know, and I think that just goes to show the kind of confidence and swagger this guy has. Honestly, I think I need to stop hyping him up because he's gonna definitely comment about it later when we get to the apartment.
I was gonna say you show him that roommate love there, and he's not gonna like that.
Yeah, I think I'm gonna start being too nice to him because then he's gonna expect me to like do the dishes and maybe do his laundry for him, and we don't need any of that.
Well, I'll make Burloff do it.
Yeah,
gonna get a visit to the mound. Looks like we are gonna have another pitching change. We are here in the bottom of the fifth inning. Cardinals lead it 2-0. Have the bases loaded with 2 outs. Third pitcher of the game to work for the Rhode Island Rams is Dominic Pacone. Threw a little bit on a Friday night. He is a freshman from Garnet Valley, Pennsylvania. Has his work cut out for him as he will be facing Cole Coker. Cole's 0-for-2 but has made good contact both times up. Grounded out to short and flew to left. Has a chance to blow it open here in the fifth inning with the bases loaded, two down. And Pacone's job is just to try to get this third out of the inning. Pitch on the way, good heavy swing.
Big swing it from Hollywood, first pitch, I like it. Why not? You know, look good, take a hack. Swing hard in case you hit it. That's my favorite hitting advice.
Cardinals have the bags full, no balls, one strike on Coker. The 0-1 pitch. Catches the outside corner for a called strike, 0-2.
That ball seemed like a little bit off the plate, and as my buddy Alex would say, that ain't it.
No balls, two strikes. The 0-2 pitch misses outside and away for a ball.
Good take. 1-2.
And that's kind of a tough pitch to lay off of, too.
Oh, absolutely, especially when an umpire expands his zone maybe for a strike one or two call, as a hitter, subconsciously you got to know, hey, he's going to call it out there, so you got to expand with the umpire. Sometimes none worse than being rung up on a call you know the umpire is going to call.
1-2 pitch, curveball misses outside for ball 2-2. If you get to work it to 3-2, the runners will be going on the pitch. But a gapper here would open it up. With McCall at third, and then great speed. Nothing against Rhett, but great speed behind him with Avery George and Cole Gerard. Down low for a ball. Another good take, 3-2.
Full count here. And everyone in the stands and listening should know that this guy, number 7, is going to want some to hit here. Now, his job is just stay within himself and not try to hit it 700 feet over the right field wall. He's just trying to maybe barrel some and see if it finds a hole.
Well, if he can hit it 700 feet, we'll take it.
Well, if you can hit it 700 feet, Harold, I'll cook him dinner tonight. So we'll see if that happens.
3-2 pitch on the way, swing and a miss, strike 3 for the final out of the inning. But the Cardinals do get a run, one run on a big triple by Kelby Weiler. One hit, no errors, and the Cardinals leave them full. The Cardinals left five on through five. 2-0, Lamar leads it as we move to the top of inning number 6. 7-8-9, bottom third of the batting order, to face Austin Faith. There's a called strike. Although he's given up a walk and a hit, he has faced a minimum through five. As the Cardinals were able to get a pickoff and a double play. The 0-1 pitch on the way, down for a ball, 1-1.
Yeah, and Austin's done a good job at doing the things that a pitcher needs to do that have nothing to do with pitching, and that those are things like, you know, filling your position and picking off. He's done a good job with those.
1-1 pitch is pitch number 60 outside for a ball. Ken Austin played at Navarro Junior College, A&M Kingsville, out of Magnolia High School. Well, a 2-1 pitch on the way, high and outside for a ball, 3-1. Good find for this Lamar pitching staff. Ready for a 3-1 pitch.
Good pitch right there.
Called strike. He tried to check his swing. I think he checked it, but it didn't matter. It was in the zone. Three balls, two strikes. 3-2 pitch. That's rolled up to first base side. Going to be fielded and nobody on the bag. Infield single for Austin White. Kemp came in and there was nobody there.
I think the hesitation there from Austin came from maybe thinking that he had fouled it off his foot, which is honestly, I thought he fouled it off his foot too, because usually that's a play that, you know, we've done a couple hundred times in practice, and, you know, Austin knows his job is to get the first and Chase's job is to get the ball, but I think that just that miscommunication happened because there was no one sure if that was a fair foul ball.
Joe Fortin. And it was for J.C. over at second. That was just too far for him to run,
right,
to come over and cover. First pitch is a ball to Fortin. Grounded into a 6-3 double play back in the third inning. And, of course, Cardinal fans would love a little deja vu on this one. Here's the 1-0 pitch, held way outside. Now we have left-handed action in the Lamar bullpen. Can't pick up the number.
That's Max Mize warming up back there. Max Mize is in the pen.
Sean Snedeker, Cardinal pitching coach, is going to go to the mound, and he tells the rest of the infield to stay away. Usually it's a meeting of the minds, and everybody on the infield comes into the meeting, and Sned just said, "Nah, this is going to go on between me, Austin, and Rhett."
Yeah, this right here. Sned's just probably talking mechanics with Austin, telling him, "Hey, you know, you've done a great job. Just stay within yourself, and also just to check in and see if he's doing okay." Because I mean, even though it's the sixth inning, you know, Austin hadn't thrown six innings in a long time, probably since last year. So he's
about the 64 pitches,
which is, I'm sure, fine. I'm sure he's thrown many more in a game, but it's been a while since he's thrown that many a game, and, you know, it being still relatively not too late in the game, and with Max in the pen, you just want to find out if he's fine out there.
Two balls, no strikes, 2-0 pitch. Misses ball three. A leadoff infield single and a 3-0 count here on Joe Fortin. We've seen all weekend long Rhode Island players swinging 3-0. Pitch coming in, taken all the way, called strike one. We're down by two and a runner on first base. I think it's usually a good idea on 3-0 to take.
I mean, even right now, I wouldn't think it'd be a bad idea to take, you know, with someone.
He'd have to look for something in his zone if not there.
Right, Fortin hasn't struck out too much, and he puts contact on the ball. Right there is a good example of it.
Ball four.
Now the question becomes is if they let Austin dig himself out of the hole he put himself in.
With the number nine hitter coming up, Tino Salgado, and he got the top of the order behind him. I would not be surprised at all to see Rhode Island trying to bunt the runners over.
It's probably what's expected here.
Now, when Rhett goes out there, now you've done this thousands of times too, the signals, what are you telling the infield?
Basically, just kind of where the priority of the play is, you know, depending on the game situation or what the situation calls for. Sometimes you might want to focus on getting the out at third or on where the bunt is placed. There's a lot of different plays that different teams do, but right there is just kind of figuring out where the out's going to be. And I'm assuming, you know, with the top of the order coming up, it'll just make sure to get one out. You know, if they're going to hand you an out by bunting it, do everything in your power to get one, you know. Because if you let them get on base and you got bases loaded with the top of the lineup, or if you throw it away, then it's a whole new ball game. You know, both runs could score.
Chase Kemp called timeout. Cardinals first baseman wanted to talk to his pitcher, Austin Faith. Not holding a runner at first. That might have been part of the conversation. Runners at first and second, nobody out. Rhode Island with their biggest threat of this game, with Lamar leading 2-0 here in the sixth inning. Tino Salgado, a strikeout victim, his first time up at the plate. And now that's going to be the end of the day for Austin Faith, as Coach Snedeker making his way to the mound. And from his teammates and from this home crowd here at Vincent Beck Stadium, Austin should get a pretty good reception. Good outing for... New pitcher in the ball game for your Lamar Cardinals is Max Mize. Wears number 18, left-hander, 5'11", 170. Out of Seven Lakes High School in Katy by way of McLennan Community College. In relief of Austin Faith, 5 innings, 2 hits, 3 strikeouts, 2 walks. The 2 runners on are his responsibility. We saw him a little bit on Friday night, but what can we expect out of Max?
Max is just going to pump strikes right here. Here's a guy, he knows that he's got runners on, and you know, with that guy getting on with the walk, Max is just going to try to minimize as much as he can and try to see if the Rams can get themselves out.
Runners at first and second, nobody out. Runner showing bunt, bunts it in the air, and Rhett tried to make that play behind play just too far from him, and he knew this is a sacrifice situation for Rhode Island.
Yeah, and Chase Kemp and Anthony Kerrion, them being at the corners, don't be surprised if you see him crashing pretty aggressively here, because bunt situation is probably still on.
No balls, 1 strike, especially when they have the top of their batting order coming up. Mize, they square. Just missed with the ball. 1 ball, no strikes. Good-looking pitcher, Max. Just didn't get the call. 1 ball, 1 strike. A single by Austin White and a walk by Joe Fortin for Rhode Island. They're making a threat here. Rams have runners at first and second and nobody out. top of the sixth here in Beaumont. Lamar leads it 2-0. Bunt again. There's a called strike. I won't say that the previous pitch looked better because I just won't say that.
And being down two strikes will be interesting to see if the Rams stick to the bunt approach. You know, some teams don't like bunt with two strikes, but...
It's how much confidence you have in your hitter.
Absolutely.
The two strikes may take the bunt off. With Max Mize coming in. Pitch outside, did not show bunt. It goes 2-2. Now, as a catcher, do you ever talk to the hitter?
I usually only talk to the hitter when I've got like a relationship with them. Okay. Sometimes after a weekend, you know, some hitters are nice enough to pat you on the shin, hey, how you doing, catch. But for the most part, guys usually tend to keep to themselves. Me, obviously, I mean, I'm up here talking with you. I'm a chatty Cathy. I like to talk, so.
2-2 pitch on the way, grounded foul, third base side. 2-2. Does a catcher dislike, you see this a lot in the majors, a catcher will look up at the hitter. Do you not like them looking down when you're giving a swing?
Oh, that, I think, I like to consider myself a pretty peaceful guy, but when people try to steal my signs, like when I'm putting them down, that is a really big pet peeve of mine. I've actually, the only almost brawl, I guess you could say, or fight that have happened on a field was because of that. You know, people trying to peek and see. And unfortunately, it happens more than you think. You'd get guys you think are kind of sneaky and look down, pretending to be looking down at their knuckles or something, and they're really just trying to get a peek as to what you're putting down. So that's why.
I hope it wasn't Williamsport.
Yeah, in Williamsport, it was a little bit different than that.
I'm just picking on you. Two balls, two strikes on Tino Salgado. Runners at first and second. Nobody out for Rhode Island. Lamar leading here in the sixth inning. 2-0. Cardinals with single runs in the third and fifth innings. Both runners on base. Responsibility of Austin Faith. Max Mize in out of the bullpen trying to close it down here in the sixth. Upstairs for ball 3-2. When there's two outs, it's automatic. Runners take off on a 3-2 pitch. Let's see if Rhode Island decides to do it here with nobody out.
That'd be a bold move.
It would, with nobody out.
Hey, you might want to get something going there, though, because those two runs could be big.
Runners not going. Ball popped back up over the press box. 3-2. Three balls, two strikes. Mize in a good battle here with Tino Salgado, who's fouled off a couple pitches. Pitch on the way, down low, ball 4, and Rhode Island have loaded them up with nobody out. And the top of the bat order coming up. Big opportunity coming here for Rhode Island.
And this is a big spot here, but knowing Max Mize, I wouldn't really think much of it. I think Max has got good enough composure to where, you know, he's gonna minimize, at least try to, pretty well here.
Josh Brodeur tried to bunt his way on into first inning, failed, got thrown out, and then he grounded to second. Cardinals playing Q tight at third base. Chase in a few steps at first. Gonna play double play up the middle. JC's coming in a few steps. There's a ball hit out towards Correa. He comes up. He's gonna tag the runner for one and throw the. Whoa! They call him safe at first.
That was a close play, but I don't think they're gonna challenge it.
So one out in the inning as Fortin is tagged out. 4 unassisted for the first out. Give a fielder's choice RBI to Brodeur. It's 2-1. That ball wasn't hit hard enough for JC to come home with it.
And that's one of those instances where you want the ball to be hit soft. If that ball is hit 5-10 mile an hour faster, then you got two outs instead of one.
Yeah, it could be 4-2-3 double play. But JC did the smart thing. He waited and tagged the runner, then tried to throw the run out first. And Brodeur able to beat out the throw. Runners at the corners, one out, 2-1 Lamar. Mize's pitch is on the way, drops in for a strike. 0-1.
Right now, Rhett's probably wishing that the guy first takes off. You know, as a catcher, You do a lot of blocking and catching, but when you get a chance to throw someone out, that's when you get pumped up.
Trying to check his swing and appeal down to first base. Yes, sir, says Jared Higdon. It's 0-2. A strikeout or a double play is what the Cardinals are really looking for here, with a potential tying run at third base 90 feet up the line for Rhode Island. 0-2 pitch on the way. Swing and a miss. Strike three. Big K there. Knockout for Max Mize.
There's that Bugs Bunny changeup we were talking about on Friday, Harold. It looks like a fastball, and then last minute, it slows down about 10 miles an hour.
Does that have a lot to do with the release point?
Changeup's more about how the pitcher grips it, but okay. Being a left-handed and being a guy who doesn't already necessarily throw overly hard, Max's changeup is particularly different just because his spin makes it slow down even more.
Jackson Coots 0-2. There's a strike. In the inning, one run on one hit, a couple of walks by Lamar pitching. Runners at the corners. Ball hit out towards center field. Cole Gerard comes in. That ball's going to drop in and tie the game up. Jackson Coots drives in a run. His second RBI of the weekend. His other was a solo home run on Friday night. We are tied at 2.
Got ourselves a new ball game here, folks, and it's not even noon.
Seventh hitter in the inning for the Rams of Rhode Island, Xavier Vargas, grounded out to first and got called out on strikes. Vargas, the first baseman, had a home run Friday night. There's a called strike, 0-1. Max comes in with the 0-1 pitch, fouled back to the screen. Austin Faith, 5 innings, 2 hits, 2 runs, 3 strikeouts, 2 walks. Both the runs on the board are earned. An error assisted Lamar in one of their 2 runs. Vargas down at the count, 0-2. Max looking to shut down the inning right here. Missing for a ball. Not a bad 0-2 pitch.
No, when you're 0-2, you want to basically do everything in your power to get the hitter to chase. You don't want to throw anything that the hitter can put a barrel on, especially when you're way ahead, and even more so with a runner on second base.
1-2. 1-2 pitch hit out to the air to center field. Gerard backing up a few steps, still backpedaling, will make the catch for the final out of the inning. But it was a good inning for the Rhode Island Rams. 2 runs on 2 hits, no errors, and 2 left aboard. We head to the bottom of the 6th inning from Vincent Beck Stadium. Our new score is Lamar 2, Rhode Island 2.
Now pitching for Rhode Island, number 25, Sean
Spato. Sean Spato is the new pitcher for the University of Rhode Island. Spasato is out of Ashaway, Rhode Island. J.C. Correa to lead it off here for the Cardinals, 0-2. Potential double taken away from him in the second inning by great play by Xavier Vargas, and then a routine ground out in the fourth. First 2 days, 7 out of 9 for the Cardinals. Pitch on the way to him by Zapata, misses. Posado, pitcher number 4 to work in the game for the Rhode Island Rams. 2 balls, no strikes. Guys he wanted to play right now, 4, 5, and 6 for the Cardinals.
They got the heavy hitters, and after them tying the game, I'm sure they're hungry to see if they can get some runs of their own.
Pitch fouled over, waking them up in the Rhode Island dugout. 2-1. J.C. had 10 long ones last year.
He told me he wanted to see if he can get 5 before April. So.
Good-looking curveball called for a strike, 2-2. 2 balls and 2 strikes on J.C. Correa, Cardinals second baseman. There's a ball hit hard and foul. Now, does his mom still bring that home-cooked meal to the home cooking in the clubhouse?
Not all the time, but she definitely gives him food at home, and every time she's in town, I make sure I find myself at his apartment.
Go over and visit, see how JC's doing?
Yeah, I always try to see if he's doing okay, and then maybe see if I can get some arroz con pollo or something.
2-2 pitch fouled again, third base side. JC will be followed by Chase Kemp and then Anthony Kirion.
Is it bold if I say I think one of those three guys is going to hit it out? I think it's pretty bold, but I'm going to say it anyway.
Well, let's see how bold you are here. There's a shot pretty well hit towards center field, and White coming over and makes the catch. Hits off the gap in left center field. Chase Kemp, fly out to left and a ground out to third. This is a local product coming out of high school, high touted, stayed right here in Southeast Texas after playing at Nederland High School. Good to see the local products from right here in Southeast Texas. Wastes the first pitch, misses outside for a ball.
Good eye, good eye. And something about Chase Kemp that it's really impressive is he's a power hitter, but I don't know if I've played with too many guys that are as big and strong as Chase Kemp and keep their strikeouts numbers really low. He doesn't strike out very often.
2-0 on Chase. Again, a Nederland Bulldog, and of course we have Cole Gerard, Logan Lejeune, among the car, his teammate,
I think
rivals at P&G. Rackania from P&G as well. Brendan Crater now, a former Bulldog, part of the Tamar. Don't know if you know how big of a rivalry that is, Nederland and Port Neches.
Oh, that's I've heard that's I think there's like 4 or 5 guys that are part of that. And Ranicki's also went to PNG too. So there's a couple guys from here that usually go to the high school football games in the fall.
Among 13,000 other fans.
Yeah.
The 2-1 pitch on the way, fouls it back and out of play, 2-2. Now, your high school was?
I went to Kempner High School.
Who is your arch rival?
I don't even know if we have an arch rival. We're kind of like the Switzerland of our district. You know, we're just kind of neutral.
Just kind of there?
Or maybe I just have no idea who our rival is, and that just shows how bad of a fan I am. Maybe Clements? I'm not really sure.
Either that or you're just more focused on what opponent you were facing.
Right.
2-2 pitch on the way. Oh, got him with a pitch on the corner on the knees for a called strike.
Yeah, and right there you could go ahead and talk bad about the umpire. You could say that that was a bad call. But me, I'm just going to say that was a good job by the catcher. I mean, he did a good job of getting under that ball and just picking it up and turning a ball into a strike. You know, you just got to tip your cap.
Anthony Kirion, 0-2. He's flown out to right fielder Mark Culley a couple times. Bases empty, two down in a 2-2 game. Pitch fouled back to the screen, 0-1. Two runs, three hits for both teams. Only error on the board belonging to Rhode Island. The 0-1 pitch on the way, up a little bit for a ball, 1-1.
And Q's been just getting under everything here this week. And his swings are fine, his timing's off, but from what I'm seeing up here, it just looks like he's barely getting under it. See if he makes an adjustment here.
A 1-1 pitch on the way, hits it foul. You know, he's right now, Q is 0 for 10 on the year, but he's making contact.
Yeah, you know, it's unfortunately that's one of the bad parts of baseball, if you want to call it that, or one of the more challenging, I should say, is, you know, sometimes you could just be hitting the ball well, just right at him, and you just got to keep grinding. It's a tough part of the game.
1-2 pitchers, a swing and a miss. Back-to-back strikeouts in the inning. For Rhode Island, good job there by Sapota in the bottom of the sixth inning. Sean gets him 1-2-3. No runs, no hits, no errors, and no one left. Through six at Vincent Beck Stadium, we are tied at 2. Strikeout. Max hits the outside corner for a called strike. No balls, one strike. There's a swing and a miss, 0-2.
Leon took a big swing there. Took a big power hitting swing. And I saw his BP yesterday and on Friday before the game, and he's a strong dude. You know, he was able to hit some balls way out of here, and he showed it there.
Pops it up on the right side, foul territory. Now back into fair territory, J.C. Correa calls everyone off and makes the catch. One up, one down in the seventh. Alex Ramirez, a shortstop, he's 0 for 2. Lamar took a 2-0 lead with a run into third and a run into fifth. Rhode Island, an inning ago, works a couple of hits. Takes advantage of some walks, a couple of walks, and ties the game up at 2. Good inning for Rhode Island back into 6. There's a called strike on Alex Ramirez with Austin White waiting on deck. Should someone reach, Joe Fortin would come to the play. 0-2.
Back to back.
You can see his knees buckle a little bit there. Is that him waiting for a fastball and
I mean, when a knee's buckle, usually that just means that you're sitting fastball, and it's kind of like you're surprised. So that's what he just happened. He was just kind of shocked.
There's an 0-2 pitch. Red fires on to first for the put out. Two up and two down.
And that was a good pitch right there by Max. A lefty-lefty changeup is not something that you see often, and when you see guys swing over it, it's especially because of that. Exactly. It's because lefties don't usually see changeups from other lefties, you know.
First strikeout for Max since he's come in the game. Now check, that's his second. Fifth strikeout for Cardinal pitching. 0-1 on Austin White. He walked, singled an infield single, and started that two-run rally for Rhode Island an inning ago. There's a foul tip on a swing and a miss. It's 0-2. That's doing exactly what you want to do if you're Max, working in front of the hitter. O2 pitch on the way, flirted with the outside corner, just outside for a ball, 1-2.
That's a good two-strike fastball, making sure that it's off the plate.
1-2 pitch on the way, misses inside to even it up at 2-2. Not bad back-to-back pitches, although they were out of the strike zone. They weren't too bad pitches there.
And that's what Max was trying to do, trying to get him to chase. You know, Max is smart enough to where he knows with two strikes, you don't want to just throw a strike. You want to be able to get the guy to get himself out.
Comes that 2-2 pitch, hit him in the helmet.
That never feels good.
That's why you wear him.
That's why I wear him.
One that just got away from Max Mize. Because the last thing you want to do is put a runner on with the potential go-ahead run on with two outs in an inning.
Right. And something I always found interesting is how in, like, Japan or Korea, you peg a guy, the pitcher takes their hats off and bow. I always thought that was kind of an interesting culture thing that they did. Obviously, Max didn't do that, but just a random thought that I had right there.
More on that after the first pitch from Joe Fortin, the second baseman, hit into a double play and walked. You'll see, if you watch the Little League World Series in Williamsport, if a player from Japan, Taiwan, or something hit a batter, they'll go over to first base and shake his hand.
Oh, yeah, I remember that actually happened to us. I think I remember we were all just kind of like shocked that it happened.
The 0-1 pitch on the way. Misses for ball, one strike. 0-2, excuse me.
That was a good job of Red, just waiting for the ball to catch that as deep as he could. That way, if you don't have to stick it out and wait for it to just land in the strike zone. Rhett did a good job of letting the ball get deeper there.
No balls, two strikes, one on, two outs. Lefty versus lefty. The 0-2 pitch on the way. Head out towards center field. Long run for Cole Girard. That ball's going to bounce in, and it'll be a first and third situation for Rhode Island. Two out noise here in the top of the seventh for the Rams. And the number nine hitter in the batting order, Tino Salgado, he struck out in the third inning, walked and scored a run in the sixth. Pitching coach Sean Snedeker on his way to the mound for Lamar. So Rhode Island with a threat here. And we'll see if they're going to go to the bullpen. No indication yet. I think Jack Dallas is ready. I think that's who was throwing for Lamar, the junior pitcher from West Orange Stark High School. And they are going to go to the bullpen. So it's a pitching change with two on and two outs here in the seventh. Lamar and Rhode Island tied at two.
we're out here on the field or if we're just playing 2K or grilling, you know, he's going to try to beat you at making a hamburger. He's going to try to beat you, you know, playing 2K, and he's going to try to do everything he can to win. And he loves doing it. He's a fun guy to be around. Probably arguably one of the best mustaches in the Southland Conference. I'm not going to comment on whether he dyed it or not. That's none of my concern. But this guy, you know, he's an athlete, and he's a guy that everyone loves to be around in the clubhouse. A lot of energy, jokes around and likes to have fun, but knows when to get focused and locked in when it's time. And that's something that I'm sure we'll see right here.
Max Mize tossed 32 pitches, an inning and two-thirds. Two hits, two strikes and a walk. No runs, but both the runners on base at first and third are his responsibility. Austin White hit by pitch with two outs. And then a Fortin single set up this first and third situation. Now Jack Dallas against Tino Salgado. Misses for a ball, one ball, no strikes. Jack, one of the more emotional guys on this team as well.
Oh yeah, he'll get pumped up and he'll let you know if he is. And that's good. Sometimes it's good to have a guy like that on the mound because the defense feeds off that energy.
One ball, no strikes. 1-0 pitch hit out towards right field. That could be trouble. It will be to drop in for a base hit and give Rhode Island the lead. Here's a strong throw towards third, not in time. And the Rams take a 3-2 lead on the RBI single opposite field hit by Tino Salgado. Fortin goes all the way to third.
And I know that gets under Jack's skin, you know, because he made a good pitch, and it's one of those instances where if that was a wooden bat, that bat shattered, you know. And
He saws him off.
He sawed him off, and he did everything he could, but it just found a hole right in that Bermuda Triangle. But we'll see if he bounces back and gets the leadoff guy here.
Josh Brodeur is 0-for-3 with an RBI. Takes the first pitch on the corner. Started a ball game off, tried to bunt his way on. Went back to the mound. Austin Faith threw him out. Then he grounded out to second. Reached on a fielder's choice and drove in a run an inning ago. 3-2 Rhode Island here in the seventh inning. Pitch inside for a ball. One ball, one strike. Three runs, five hits, one error for Rhode Island. 2-3-0 for Lamar. Here's the 1-1 pitch. Catches the outside corner. Good pitch here by Jack. It's a good baseball name, too. Good football baseball name, Jack Dallas.
Jack Dallas sounds like a guy you hear at SportsCenter every night. And we actually got a couple guys with pretty cool names.
Pitch gets away. It's going to scoot back to the backstop down in the dirt. And that'll give a bonus run, an assurance run here for Rhode Island. One ball, two strikes.
And that's a tough pitch to block. You know, Rhett's definitely upset about that one, but it's one of those ones that you think it's going to break. It's one of those sliders that you think is going to break a little bit more to your right, and it ends up just kind of staying flat and going straight down to your left. Kind of a tough pitch to block right there.
4-2 Rhode Island. 1-2, two outs, one on. And ball hit out towards left field right at Reese Duran. Makes about a knee-high catch for the final out of the inning. Rhode Island grabs the lead. Two runs on three hits. Two runs, two hits, no errors, and one left. It's time to stand up and stretch them out. Rhode Island leading 4-2. Batting order coming up here for Lamar, starting with Reese Duran. Tried to bunt his way on his first time up, just thrown out. And then he walked and scored one of the two Lamar runs. Scored the run that was scored in the fifth inning. Fouls it off opposite way. It's one ball, one strike. Good pitching here by both sides. Rhode Island with a 4-2 lead right now, taking two runs in the top of the seventh inning. The 1-1 pitch on the way. There's a swing and a miss. One ball, two strikes, a 1-2 pitch on the way. There's a good way to start the inning. A wrap into right center field. Good wide turn by Reese Duran.
And that's good right there, because with Kelby coming up, that opens up a ton of possibilities for what the offense can do here. You know, Kelby could maybe sacrifice him and moving over with Logan Berloff pinch hitting on deck. And, you know, or you just let Kelby swing. He's fast enough to where if he does hit a ground ball, he could beat out a double play. So let's see what they choose to do here.
Just missed a round tripper his last time up at the RBI triple. First pitch to him, fouled on that third base side, bounces into the stands and back onto the field. Can't tell. Yeah, we do have a lefty warming in Lamar, just kind of a soft toss in the Lamar bullpen. Nobody's throwing for Rhode Island, but they do have about four or five guys down there. Tie and run at the plate for Lamar here in the seventh inning. Go the other direction with the foul ball into the stands on the first base side. Kids giving chase. No balls, two strikes. Logan Berloff, as Jorge had mentioned, grabbed the bat. He's in the on death circle. There's a ground ball towards deep short into left field for a base hit. Back-to-back singles, a start, the seventh for Lamar, and Berloff coming to the plate.
Rhett's coming up to the plate.
They're going to pull him back?
They're going to let him swing it.
There you go. Okay, so Rhett McCall will bat. They had Berloff in the on deck circle. Now the difference between Major League Baseball and high school / college is you're not a batter until you report to the umpire. In the major leagues, I think if you get onto the on deck circle, you're counted.
Yeah, once you're out there, you're out there. And I think the only reason is they let Rhett go up here is because, you know, I'm thinking maybe coach is gonna see if he can maybe try to do a hit and run action type deal or maybe get a bunt down. But Rhett and Logan are both more than capable of getting the job here. But the idea is to get runners in scoring position for the top of the lineup.
Coach Will Davis calling Rhett over. You're going to have a little conversation with him. Well, what do you think is being talked about here?
I think Coach Davis is just prioritizing and letting Rhett know how important the guys at first and second are and how valuable or how much more valuable they would be if they were in scoring position. You know, maybe he's saying, hey, I know that you can hit, but we need you to get this bunt down right here and get these guys so that Avery George or Gerard or Coker can bring those guys in and tie this game up.
Four runs, five hits, one error for Rhode Island, 2-5-0 for Lamar. The hits are even up at five. And the Cardinals with an opportunity here as back-to-back single to start the seventh by Reese Duran and Kelby Weiler. Weiler's had a good ball game. He's 2 out of 3, and his flyout where Austin White made a beautiful diving towards the infield catch out in center field to take a hit away. And Kelby came in hitting .571 on the weekend. He's had a very good weekend, as has Avery George and J.C. Correa. Just got to time the hips together.
It's all about timely hitting. It's all about timely hitting, and that's what we're going to try to get some out of Rhett here, see if he can do some of that clutch magic.
Tied at the corners, expecting bunt. He does. He gets the bunt down. Play will be first base, and he got his job. He did his job. He got the sack bunt down to advance the runners into scoring position with the top of the order coming up.
And that's big, Harold. You know, when you get a bunt down, it doesn't seem like a lot, but what that does in the dugout is that it gets the people – gets the team going because we know that our plan is being executed. You know, now we got runners where we want them. Now we got Avery George, our guy at the plate. And if he doesn't do it, then we got a guy right behind him, Cole Gerard, who's going to try to get those runs in.
I like that Geyer.
Geyer.
Avery George is 2-for-2 with an RBI and hit by a pitch. Runners at second and third, infield tight here for Rhode Island. Pitch on the way to Ave. It'll be called strike one. See the reaction there of Avery. Steps out a little bit, not happy with that. He thought that pitch was a little tight. Base hit could tie this thing up. The 0-1 pitch on the way. Ball's going to bounce away. Nice job by Sonny Juliana knocking that ball down, keeping a runner at third base.
Yeah, that was a big block right there. I mean, that run, that ball gets away, that's a run, and it's just a bloop away from tying the game. So that's important.
1-1 with one out and two on. Spasota comes in with the pitch. Inside for a ball, 2-1. Sean Spasota, the fourth pitcher to work here for the Rhode Island Rams. Comes a 2-1 pitch on the way. Down low, another nice block by Sonny Juliana. And this, you know, it's almost like an echo or just repeating ourselves over and over, skipping record, but a 3-1 count in this situation. Avery has a good opportunity here.
Oh, yeah, Avery's definitely going to be wanting something to hit right here. But the Rams also know that they got an open base, so they can't give him a cookie.
There's ball four.
Yeah, when you got an open base and runners in scoring position, especially with someone who's seeing the ball like Avery, sometimes it's better if you just kind of let him get to first, you know, because even though Cole Gerard is a good ball player, if you got a runner at first and the force play applying everywhere, Cole could do what he did earlier and just line into one and get a double play for the Rams.
Could see the sidewinder coming in for Rhode Island warming up in the bullpen. They've made the move. We're going to get a pitching change. Cardinals have loaded them up here in the seventh inning and a 4-2 lead for Rhode Island. Rhode Island goes to the bullpen. New pitcher in the game is Tyler Brocious. Brocious from Denville, New Jersey, the sidewinder we saw on Friday night a little bit.
Yeah, this sidewinder, I think they know exactly why they're bringing him in. He's got good numbers against lefties, and with Gerard and Coker coming up, I'm sure that the Rams want to see if they can ground it into a double play and maybe miss out on a big inning for the Cards.
Going to be facing the lefty, Cole Gerard, and then Cole Coker back-to-back, couple left-handed hitters. I would think with a sidewinder right-hander, it'd be a little harder for a right-handed hitter to pick it up.
Right, and, you know, sometimes that's the case, but there are some guys that throw from down there that just, me as a switcher, I've seen sidearm guys from both sides, you know, and I can say that some guys just release it away to where it's hard to read, especially here with the white signs out in center field and the big LU, you know, in the middle of center field. The ball sometimes mixes in with those white in those signs, and it becomes hard to read and hard to pick up.
Opportunity for the Cardinals to get back in this thing, trailing 4-2. Bases loaded, one out. Girard at the plate. 0-2 with a walk. Senior center fielder from Port Neches takes the first pitch on the outside corner for a called strike. Cole lined out into first inning, lined into a double play on a ball he's probably hit the hardest so far this season in a short season. Struck out and walked. No balls, one strike. Brogius comes into the 0-1 pitch, popped up and out of play. It's 0-2. Both bullpens are quiet. Cardinal fans would love to see Girard get around on one here and drive it somewhere.
I'm sure Girard would want to see that too.
Tyler Brogius ready to come in with the 0-2. Misses outside for a ball, 1-2.
It's a big at bat right here, Harold. I mean, you get one run or two runs here, it changes the whole dynamic of the game. And if they're able to hold him off and get Cole to come up with the bases loaded, that's also another big situation. So this is a pretty stressful time for the pitcher up there.
1-2 pitch underway, called strike three on the outside corner.
That's strike.
Strike two?
Yeah. That
the board was wrong then.
Yeah, no, I'm thinking.
Now they're going to say that's strike two. Okay, yeah, I thought so. So that is the second out of the inning. Need two out help here from Cole Coker. 0-3. A ground out, a fly out, and a strikeout. So Tyler Brogius. When he come in with the pitch, and he lays down a bunt. They're going to throw it at home and tag him out for the final out of the inning. So give Fielder's Choice credit for Cole Coker, and the play made it to plate, 1-2 for the third out of the inning. No runs on a couple of hits, no errors, and they left them full. We've played 7, our score, Rhode Island 4, Lamar 2. Jack Dallas, first pitch, called strike one. Mark Coley is 1-3, flew to right, singled, and struck out. Jack Dallas ready to come in with the pitchers. A swing. Ball popped up the first base side, foul for strike two. It's 0-2.
And it being that, you know, already the eighth inning and the Cards down by two, I'm sure Jack is taking it as a personal responsibility here to try to get the Cards back in the dugout with no one even getting on. So I'm sure he wants to have a quick and efficient inning right here.
The 0-2 pitch on the way, swing and a miss, strike three. Good start, three pitches and a strikeout.
A shout out to Rhett there, moving around a lot behind the plate. You know, being a catcher, it's tough because it's kind of like a thankless job. People don't come up to you and say, good job. You know, they don't come up to you and thank you, or they don't high-five you. It's a tough position to be in, and you're just expected to work hard and be great back there. So I just want to give a shout-out to Rhett and also for Uliana for the Rams, too, for doing a good job.
Catcher speaking to catchers.
I feel like catcher love needs to be spread out more. You know, catchers got to look out for each other.
Someone's got to watch your backs.
Somebody's got to do it, and it might as well be me, huh?
Absolutely. Jackson Kusa, DH, 1-for-3. There's a one ball, one strike count. Six strikeouts for Cardinals pitching this afternoon. With the Jack Dallas. Did have a lefty. We still do have a lefty and a righty throwing for Lamar. There's a high ground ball towards first, foul ball.
Yeah, it's going to be Christian Grigsby warming up in the pen, and I think that may be Matt McDonald just getting loose to see if he pinch hits or gets an at-bat in the outfield. I'm not really sure who else that is, but Christian Grigsby's a lefty. Hopefully you don't even need him right here. Hopefully JD just kind of cruises through him. We'll see what happens.
The 1-2 pitch on the way, time called, and how frustrating is that? I mean, you could hear the crowd. You could see Jack extend his arms a little bit. You know, it's a discretion of the umpire whether or not to allow the hitter to have timeout. But I think once the pitcher has made his move towards home, you don't get it.
I feel like you just got to let him go. And Jack being the competitor he is and him knowing that this is a big inning for him, he definitely does not want any part of that going on. And I'm sure he's going to rear back and try to get him a little more right here.
1-2 pitch on the way. Catches the outside corner for a called strike. Back-to-back strikeouts to start the eighth inning.
I love that out of Jack. You know, he didn't get it. He got disrupted basically the pitch before, and he rears back and he says, you know what? Hit this one again. And he threw it again, and he got him. And after the pitch, you could even see a little fist bump and a little – he bucked at him a little bit. And you got to love to see that, you know, being a competitor.
The Jack Dallas, it's going to be hard to find, you know, a tougher competitor. First pitch is a ball to Xavier Vargas, the first baseman. He's 0-for-3, a ground out to first, a called out on strikes into fifth, and flew out to center into sixth. Ball 2-0. Going back to that, you know, it's up to the home plate umpire to give the discretion to give the hitter the timeout he asked for it. But a lot of times you see a pitcher already in their motion. I think you just let the pitcher go ahead and throw the ball.
Yeah, I mean, and as a catcher, that kind of bothers you too because, like I said earlier, pitching, all it is upsetting timing. So when you upset the pitcher's timing, it's kind of like you're flipping the switch, and it's not something that pitchers want to feel at all times because they want to dictate the speed of the game. So when a hitter messes up the pitcher's timing, then it gets all out of hurl.
2-1 pitch called strike two, and I have seen, I'm sure you have too, Jorge, to where a hitter calls timeout, steps out of the box, and the umpire don't grant it, and the pitcher's thrown into the strike.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it goes both ways. Sometimes you call time at the very beginning, and you're just waiting for the umpire to give it to you, and it never happens. And sometimes you call it for last second, and for whatever reason, the umpire will just give it to you, and you see that the pitcher gets upset.
2-2 pitch on the way. Misses ball three. Count runs full. Full count, two outs, nobody on. 4-2 Rhode Island. The Rams with two runs into sixth and two runs into seventh. Lamar has split their runs, one into fifth and one into third. Here comes that 3-2 pitch. Misses ball four for a walk. So a two-out walk here in the eighth inning.
Catcher number 35, Sonny Juliana.
Here's Sonny Juliana. 0-for-3, a fly out, a strikeout, and a pop out. no damage done by that two-out walk if you can get Juliana. He sends a fly ball towards Avery George out in right field.
Got a guy there.
Yep. No runs, no hits, no errors, one left. Head to the bottom of the eighth, starting to get late. It's Rhode Island 4, Lamar 2. Well, the Cardinals have 4, 5, and 6. Heart of the batting order, Harold Mann along with Jorge Gutierrez. Cardinal baseball on YouTube Live this afternoon. Rhode Island trying to avoid the sweep. Lamar won Friday night and yesterday afternoon. And J.C. Correa is going to try to get Lamar back in it here in the eighth. First pitch to him, down for a ball. J.C., 7 out of 9 for the weekend coming in. Good defensive play, retired in the second inning, grounded out and flew out. He's made contact all three times. 1-0 pitch on the way. There's a ball hit off his leg. 1-1. Go tag him if you want. Go up there and do that. Brochure was going to go up and tag him, thinking it was a fair ball, but J.C. standing right there in the batter's box. Home plate umpire Michael Grisham had already called it a foul ball because it hit his front leg.
I think the game's getting a little antsy, Harold. I think people are just kind of getting, you know, it's late in the game, and people just want outs however they can get them.
1-1. There's a good-looking pitch. Catches the inside corner for a called strike, 1-2. Hits are even at 5. Rhode Island leading 4-2 here with the leadoff hitter on for the Cardinals at the plate. 1-2 the count on J.C. Correa. 1-2 pitch. In and out of the glove. Back to the backstop high for a ball. 2-2.
Kind of came over the top on that one. Didn't really sidearm or submarine that one. That was a little bit more. He had a little bit more on that one. Try to get it by J.C.
More of a traditional look.
Mm-hmm.
Brose is ready for the 2-2 pitch. Oh, that's inside. One bot got away from him. It's 3-2. So after falling behind in the count, J.C. battles back to see the count run full. With Chase Kemp on deck. Here comes the 3-2 pitch inside. Ball 4.
That's big right there. Leadoff walk in the bottom of the eighth to get the big boys in the order coming up. That's good at bat by J.C. right there.
Right now, head coach Rafael Serrato for Rhode Island is telling Tyler Brocious, this is your game. Nobody's thrown in the bullpen.
Yeah, no, and that just goes to show how much confidence they have on him. And they're just going to see what they can get and see if he can get himself out of this pickle here.
So Lamar Gets a leadoff on man on here in the bottom of the eighth inning, trailing by two. And Chase Kemp at the plate, looking for his first hit of the game. Came in hitting an even 500 after the first two ball games. Flew to left, grounded to third, and got called out on strikes his last time up. One ball, no strikes on him. Correa with the lead at first. Pitch on the way. Catches the outside corner for a called strike, 1-1.
I'm sure Coach Haddon's just waiting for a gap here so he can start swinging that arm and get waving JC home.
Get that windmill going.
Oh, yeah.
They're giving him a lot of room along that left field side. Boy, if he could take one down to that left field corner, called strike.
I mean, I don't think I've ever seen Chase hit one that far left field, but if he did, that would be incredibly clutch of him.
Well, he's got to protect himself and the plate right now as he's down in the count. One ball, two strikes. Tyler Broch is ahead of the Lamar first baseman. Broch is ready to come in 1-2 to Chase. And he's going to get him on the corner, called strike three. You could hear the displeasure.
Getting a lot of hate back there.
No, no love for the home plate umpire.
No love for the umpire, but you know what? Once again, you just got to tip your cap to Uliana doing a good job of receiving that pitch and getting a called strike. You know, he could have gotten lazy and just not beat it to the spot, and that's a ball, and that changes the whole at-bat and maybe the whole game. That was just a good job by Uliana, beating it to the spot and calling it a strike.
And as a hitter with two strikes on you got to be hacking anything close. First pitch is a swing and a miss by Kirion. Well, he's still looking for his first hit of the season, young season. That would be prime to get it right here.
Not a bad spot to get your first knock right here. And if it's a double, so be it. I'm sure that's what Q is looking for right here.
Roach is ready for the 0-1 pitch. Aye, there's a snap throw down to first. J.C. Correa not that far off the bag, so he gets back easily. One ball, one strike. With one on and one out. Comes the 1-1 pitch. There's a swing and a miss for strike two, 1-2. Getting up next for the Cardinals at the University of Texas, 4 o'clock on Wednesday afternoon, then over the weekend in San Marcos. One ball, two strikes. The 1-2 pitch on the way. Just gets a piece of it. Jorge and I will be back with you on YouTube again. Our next broadcast will be on the 25th, 6 o'clock first pitch when UTSA comes to town. Back here at Vincent Beck Stadium.
I got some buddies at UTSA that play there, so that'll be a fun game to broadcast. Plus, they're pretty good. It'd be a good competition.
Just be nice to them on the air. A little bit.
Just a little bit.
Just a little. One ball, two strikes. The 1-2 pitch on the way. Takes something off it. Has a swing out in front of it for a strikeout for the second out of the inning. Good pitch there by Tyler Brocious. Reese Duran tried to bunt his way on into third inning. Walked and scored into fifth. Had a single into seventh. So the Cardinals down to two outs here in the bottom of the eighth inning. There goes Correa. Pitch, throw down to second base, and he slides in safely.
That's just good baseball right there. That's good ball because now you got a good hitter and a race at the plate with JC in scoring position. You know, a bloop scores him. And even if nothing happens and Reese strikes out or whatever right here, nothing good comes out of it, you got arguably the hottest hitter in the lineup to lead off the bottom of the ninth.
One ball, no strikes on Reese Duran. 1-0 pitch on the way. There's a ground ball towards second, fielded by Fortin. Throws on to first base for the final out of the inning. Leadoff walk goes by the wayside for Lamar. No runs, no hits, no errors. One left through eight. Our score, Rhode Island 4, Lamar 2. We'll be right back. is Christian Grigsby, left-hander, 5'11", 165-pounder. Out of League City, went to Bay Area Christian High School, a transfer from Tyler Junior College. And what can you tell us about Christian?
Actually know Christian pretty well. I played with him a couple years ago in Alvin, and he's a lefty who has got pretty good stuff. He'll probably run it up to 89, 91, really good slider, good changeup. And this guy's an athlete, you know. He's one of the sneaky athletes on the team, you know. By looking at him, you wouldn't think that he can do much, but I'm pretty sure he's probably one of the best dunkers on the team, basketball-wise. And he's a nice guy, good to have around the locker room. He's pumped to have his first Division I outing right now, I can assume, so I'm excited to see how
he does. A 5'11 dunker?
5'11 dunker, and Harold, I don't know if you're aware of what Fortnite is, but this guy is one of the best Fortnite players I have ever seen.
I've heard of Fortnite. I'm not sure what it is. I know it's a video thing, and I know it's very popular.
It's dying down, but he still plays more than he should.
Good that it's dying down. Move to the ninth inning. It's 6, 7, and 8 in the batting order coming up here for Rhode Island. Did you play Fortnite?
Not enough to say, not enough, I don't think, if you ask a lot of people, but video games are really my thing growing up.
Alex Ramirez takes the ball 2-0. 0-3. Popped out, flew out, and struck out. Grigsby pops it back and out of play. Jack Dallas goes 1+, gives up a hit. Strike out a couple walks. Austin Faith got to start, went 5 innings, 2 hits, 2 runs, struck out 3. Max Mize an inning and 2/3, 2 hits and a couple of runs. 2-1 pitch on the way, good pitch here, swinging a miss on a lefty versus lefty. He's sporting a good bright red glove out there?
Oh yeah, he made sure that he got some that popped.
2 balls, 2 strikes, 2-2 pitch on the way. Just missed
good
with the
pitch.
Ball, 3-2.
And Grigsby, he reminds me movement-wise and the way they throw. He looks kind of like Jason Blanchard did last year for the Cardinals. They have similar arm action, and they kind of walk around with that 5'11 build, athletic guys. They look pretty similar out there.
3 balls, 2 strikes to the leadoff hitter, Alex Ramirez. 3-2 pitch on the way, pop back up and over top of the press box. 10 o'clock start this morning here in Beaumont because I guess Rhode Island is like a 6 o'clock flight out of Houston to head back out to Crankston.
And they're going to have to get back to the cold.
Yeah. 3-2 pitch on the way, fouled. Good day for baseball here. Today, a little chilly for Beaumont standards on Friday and Saturday. Sure, Rhode Island didn't mind it.
It's looking a little bit more like Beaumont with this cloudy and muggy weather, but we're used to it.
3-2 pitch hit hard into right field for a base hit. Good at bat for Ramirez. Takes a good wide turn at first. Leadoff single. Here in the ninth inning, as Rhode Island's looking for some insurance runs, leading 4-2.
Center fielder number 15, Austin White.
Here's Austin White, the center fielder. He's been active, been on base all 3 times. He walked into third inning, singled and scored into 6th, was hit by pitch with 2 outs into 7th, and ended up scoring 1 of 2 runs. So 2 of those runs coming after a hit batter. Shows bunt. Pitch is a fastball inside. That's a good pitch when you square around to push the guy back off the plate.
Yeah, especially when you got a guy like Smith crowding a little bit. When you get him back off as a pitcher, I feel like you feel more comfortable knowing that that's your plate out there.
Bunts it foul. 1 ball, 1 strike. Joe Fortin waits on deck.
And this game hasn't had a lot of action, Harold, but it's progressed pretty quickly. Yeah. I mean, we're already in the top of the ninth, and it's barely been a couple hours, you know? It feels like this game's kind of flown by.
Okay, let's see. 12:38. Jorge said that. All right. 1 ball, 1 strike. That's like talking like a no-hitter. You never talk about how fast the game's moving.
Hey, I feel like I'm just going to stop talking.
Well, in a while ago when we were moving real long, I go walking into the center press box, go, guys, you know what I got to say about this game? And I said, I'm not going to say it right now. Cooper Welch is good, the baseball SID. Just missed with the ball 3-1.
I really hope. I'm not going to say anymore. But
no, you're fine. I have nothing to do. I think you said you had to do laundry. I don't have anything to do.
I need some homework. But
homework. You have to do homework. I have to do laundry. 3-1. One on, nobody out. Ball hit in the air. And J.C. Correa calling for it for the Cardinals and will make the catch for out number one. Kind of like when you're in high school and middle school and grade school, you get home on Friday, you get all day Saturday, and Sunday you do your homework.
Yeah, I don't think that changes ever. I think Sunday Sunday is a day for watching football if you like football. And even if you don't like football, guess what? You still got to do homework.
That's it.
It's designated. College students around the world right now are waking up from Saturday night, and they're just doing the homework they put off all week.
Here's Joe Fortin, single and scored his last time up. Grisby Christian gets a good start getting ahead 0-1. Top of the ninth inning here at Vincent Beck Stadium, Rhode Island, trying to salvage the third and final game of this three-game series after Lamar won the first two. Taking a peek ahead in the bottom of the ninth inning, Lamar will send up 8-9-1 in the batting order. One ball, one strike. Ball's popped back out of play. We saw a couple of innings ago. Let's see, back in the seventh, actually Logan Berloff grabbed a bat and was going to pinch hit for Rhett McCall, but they pulled Rhett out to lay down the bunt, so we'll see if Logan gets the pinch hit here in the ninth.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised if we saw him up there. Obviously, it's a tough thing to do, come off the bench in the ninth and hit, but, I mean, Logan's a guy, another guy, kind of like Cole Coker and JC. These guys just hit, man. So we'll see if he gets up in the bottom of the ninth and does his job. But for now, see if Grigsby can get a ground ball.
Two balls, two strikes, one on, one out on Joe Fortin. Cardinals hoping for a double play ball here to end the inning. Ball fouled back to the screen, stays 2-2. Two balls, two strikes, one on, one out on Joe Fortin. 3:33 coming in for the weekend. There goes your runner, hit and run. Ball fouled down to the right side. With two strikes, that's more of a run and hit than a hit and run.
Right there what's going on is they're banking on if it's a ball, it's going to be in the dirt because the hitter's not going to swing on it, which is automatically entailed for the guy to get a free bag. And if it's a strike, then it's probably going to be in play, so the guy could probably get to first or third.
It's one of those misses for a ball.
Yeah. It's one of those situations where the hit and run, like you said, is more of a run and hit. It's more of the hitter protecting the guy running the bases than the guy running the bases is doing or reflecting what the hitter does.
Ready for a 3-2, one-out pitch. We'll see if the runner is going on 3-2. Going to throw over to first base. Diving back in safely is Alex Ramirez. Rhode Island hasn't even, through the first two ball games and through 8 1/3 here, has not even had a stolen base, attempted a stolen base this weekend. Runner not going. Ball 4. Pitch misses outside, and Rhode Island has runners at first and second. Tino Salgato coming to the plate. He is the third baseman.
Third baseman number 1, Tino Salgato.
Looks like someone may be now standing. Now they've got, now they're just walking around in Lamar bullpen, nobody throwing. Again, Lamar baseball packing their bags for Austin and San Marcos. And we see Sean Snedeker going out to the mound, Cardinal pitching coach. All the infield gathering on the mound, and both base runners come over to talk on the third base side.
New arm, Johnny Altman, I believe.
So we do have a pitching change. 4-2, runners at first and second, one out here in the ninth. The fifth pitcher to work for the Lamar Cardinals here this afternoon is Josh Ranicki, 6'3", 245-pound sophomore out of Port Neches Groves, another local product on this Lamar baseball team. Ranicki, a hard-throwing lefty.
Big boy Josh. Man, this guy, Harold, is strong. Ranicki is a strong both inside and out, man. He can lift a ton, and he's smart on the bound.
First pitch misses for a ball. One ball, no strikes. A leadoff single followed by a pop-out, and then a walk. Rhode Island leading Lamar 4-2. One 0 pitch on the way, way outside. That a case maybe overpowering, just coming up a little bit fired up.
Yeah, he's pumped up, you know, first outing of the year. Obviously, you got to calm down and just remember that it's a game, you know. And even though it is the top nine and it's a big situation, you just got to throw it in there.
Comes the 2-0 pitch. Good fastball catches for a called strike. About how hard will he throw?
I mean, Ranicki can run it up to like 92 or 93 miles an hour, but something that's impressive about Ranicki is he's one of those guys that doesn't really do a lot when it comes to warming up. He kind of just swings his arm three times and he's ready to go.
Ready for the 2-1 pitch. There's a fastball by him, challenged him, and blew it by him, 2-2. Two balls, two strikes, two out, one on. 4-2 Rhode Island here in the top of the ninth inning. Down a little bit for a ball.
That was not a bad spot to miss right there. That was a good pitch.
3-2. See if the runners are going with one out on 3-2. Not holding them on at first base. They are not. 3-2 pitch, swing and a miss, strike three. Good job coming in out of the bullpen for Josh Ranicki. Getting a big strikeout there.
That was a big strikeout by a big horse. And I always tell Josh, if he doesn't like pitching, that he should be a bouncer, because he's got the build and the look for it. And for the listeners at home, He is incredibly strong, like I said before. I think his warm-up on squat day is like 250 pounds, which is...
That's just a warm-up.
Basically my max, so I don't know if that's talking good about Raneke or bad about me.
Well, I won't comment on that. We'll say it's good about Josh. There's a ground ball fielded at first. Underhand toss, Raneke getting over to cover the bag. And a good job by Josh Raneke to come in, get out of the ninth. No runs on a hit, no errors, two left. Cardinals need two to extend it, three to win. We go to the bottom of the ninth inning. Rhode Island leads it 4-2.
Leading off, bottom of the ninth, your Cardinals, the shortstop, number 11, Kelly Weiler.
For the Cardinals here, first off, Chris Messina has to run Scott Hatt and his helmet out there. Scott forgot his helmet in the coaching box.
Come on, coach.
Yeah, come on now, Scott.
Heads up over there.
Either that or he just wanted Chris to get some running time.
Yeah, I just wanted Chris to get a little workout.
Kelby Weiler will lead it off. He has tripled and singled in this game to go along with a flyout where he was robbed of a great defensive play by Austin White. Also see Logan Berloff in the on-deck circle. Tyler Brosher trying to close it down here to pick up the save for Rhode Island. Pitch to Kelby on the way. Gets things started off with a base hit to center field. What a game he's having. He's 3-for-3 and with the 3-for-4 with the exception of the beautiful play by Austin White in center field. He could be wearing a 4-for-4 day.
I mean, great weekend Kelby's having. He's just seeing the ball well and sticking to his approach, you know, not trying to do too much, which is something that could definitely happen on opening weekend, but he's just sticking to his plan and doing a great job executing it.
Here's Logan Berloff. Berloff for the Cardinals, pinch hitting for catcher Rhett McCall. Out of McKinney, second year in the program, went to Panola. First pitch to him inside for a ball. If the Cardinals extend this to the 10th inning, who comes in to catch?
I think Q would come over, play catcher, and then Logan would go play third base. You know, but that's a good problem to have, is having to pick and choose who plays where with a lot of diversity we have on this team defensively.
One ball, no strikes, a 1-0 pitch, misses a ball, 2-0. Hits are tied at 6, runs advantage Rhode Island 4-2. Cardinals have the potential tying run on, nobody out, tying run at the plate, nobody on. Nobody out here in the bottom of the ninth inning, a leadoff single by Kelby Weiler. Top of the batting order, and Avery George waits on deck. 2-1 pitch on the way, swing and a miss. Strike two, 2-2. Cardinals won Friday night and yesterday afternoon. Rhode Island on top 4-2 here in the ninth inning. pitch on the way to Logan. Misses outside for a ball. As Tyler Brosher comes on that side, tried to get Logan to chase one outside the strike zone, and good patience at the plate. He laid off it.
This is a big pitch right here. This is a big pitch. See who wins this battle. Come on, Logan.
Three balls, two strikes. 3-2 pitch on the way. Swing and a miss, strike three. One down for Avery George. He's been on base all four times this afternoon. Singled in the first, RBI single in the third, hit by a pitch in the fifth, and walked in the seventh. A perfect day for the Cardinals right fielder.
The priority number one here, Harold, is not only to get Kelby over to second, but if Avery gets on, that's a big breath of fresh air for the Cards.
Takes the first pitch for a called strike, 0-1.
If I'm not mistaken, if I'm the Cards here, I'm probably taking until I get a strike, which is probably something I wouldn't be surprised if we saw from each hitter in the Cardinal lineup.
Ready for the 0-1 pitch. Is a hard hit ground ball to short. Could be the ball game. Underhand toss for one. Back across first. I forgot who's running up that first baseline. Avery George. He's a tough one to double up.
Yeah, and that ball was hit really well. So obviously, immediately, everyone here would assume that the game was going to be over because it seemed like a tailor-made double play. But you got to remember that when he wants to, Avery George could run a 3-8 or maybe a 3-9 to first base. And for the listeners that aren't listening at home, if you're running below 4 seconds of first base, that's pretty fast. So that gives that shows that hustle is one of those things that goes a long way.
Logan Lejeune will pinch hit here for Cole Girard. First pitch swinging and missing. So Logan pinch hitting for his former high school teammate. Cole Girard, both graduates of Port Neches Groves High School. No balls, one strike, one on, and two outs. There's a ball hit foul down to the third base side. This is a good opportunity for Logan, you know, coming to bat here as a pinch hitter. You could really make some noise and give yourself good opportunity if you could get on here.
Well, yeah, and it's a good opportunity to just show you're prepared because it's not easy to come off the bench. But if Logan were to do his job right here, it definitely opens up more opportunities for him in the future.
No balls, two strikes. The 0-2 pitch on the way. Upstairs for a ball, 1-2. Cole Coker waits on deck. Ready for the pitch, runner going, misses, no throw. 2-2, they just let him go.
Yeah, I mean, that run doesn't matter. You got to remember, if you're the Rams,
right,
Avery is just irrelevant. That run could score. Your main priority is to not let Lejeune get on base here.
Two balls, two strikes. Here comes that 2-2 pitch. Called strike three, there's your ball game. Wow. Can't tell you what, Sonny Giuliano, the catcher. Now you're going to talk about this when we get out of here. Turned around to extend his hand to the home plate umpire. And you see that after every game. And the home plate umpire, Michael Grisham, just patted him on the shoulder and walked away. Didn't accept the handshake.
Yeah, no, there are some umpires that are just strictly there to do a job and they leave. And then there's some umpires that will be your friend. And when every time you see them at other games or other ball fields, they'll give you a hug. But unfortunately for Giuliano, the home plate umpire here just wanted to get out of here.
And we have to get out of here, too. Jorge, been a lot of fun. Welcome aboard. We've been two of the three games. Looking forward when UTSA comes to town in a couple weeks, right back here at Vincent Beck Stadium.
Looking forward to it.
That's going to do it from Vincent Beck Stadium. Rhode Island salvages a third game, wins it 4-2. Cardinals play at Texas and Texas State next week. Final score, Rhode Island 4 and Lamar Cardinals 2 for... All right, Gutierrez, I'm Harold Mann. So long and Peckham Cards.